Good afternoon, everyone. It gives me great pleasure to be interacting with a bunch of ambitious and career-focused leaders. Today, I will be taking you through the broad findings of my research on the future of work that BD Foundation released last year, called Crystal Gazing, and what might be the workplace in 2030. We will take each of the three predictions made in the research and deconstruct it as to what does it mean for each of us. And thirdly, we will discuss on what skills should we be ready for combating the future. I would really like the session to be interactive, hence would expect everyone on the call to be mindful and present. I will be checking with all of you in intervals. And in case you want to ask me something, please do write on that chat box and I will respond back. Is that fine? Great. Pritika, yes. Thank you. Great. Is there anything that you all are expecting from this session? It'll be great to, you know, sort of get your views before we really, really start off. Is there anything that I've missed out? Anything that you would want to know? And let me see if I can, you know, sort of cover it in the session. Anybody? So Pritika, I said yes. Anuradha, I said yes. Are you able to hear us properly? Hear me properly? Okay. And Archana is asking, it would be great to touch upon automation and blockchain. Automation, definitely. And that's the first slide, in fact, that we'll be talking, Archana. Blockchain, not so much, but yeah, we can touch upon it. A little background to the paper, of course. Thank you. We'll do that and do the research. Okay, great. So, before I wanted to, you know, sort of submit, showcase the broad findings, I wanted to talk about how did the research come into place. About a year and a half back, we actually, when we were speaking to people, we realized that there were a lot of organizations who wanted to understand, because the pace of change is really, really changing very, very fast. So we thought that we should be speaking to influencers and people out there to understand their point of view and to understand how could the future workplace look like. And this was very, very from a workplace perspective, me as an employee and me as a worker in a multinational organization, in a regular organization, in an Indian organization, in a startup. How would I be, what kind of pressures would I be facing on? So basis the conversation with about 40-50 people and HR heads, and speaking to a couple of influencers across who have written papers, and of course a little bit around secondary research, we came up with this entire thing called Crystal Gazing for the year 2030. And you will be able to find this entire research on our website. Please, you can put in your email and your contact details and it'll come to you. So let me now deconstruct that entire research for you, and then let's look at it from a very personal perspective. Nancy, can you go to the next slide, please?
Sure.
Okay. So the broad three findings, and the research, you all can read it in detail, but the main three findings which I thought, and as the main research author of the paper, these were the three things which came out standing for me. One was, there will be a lot of automation with artificial intelligence and emotional intelligence, which will be there in the future of work. There will be this entire aspect of contracting, and there will be this entire aspect of people not being in the same careers as what they are today. So these are very, very interesting conversations that everybody's having. AI, data, everything, you know, everybody knows about and everybody is talking about. So let's we will talk about it in detail one by one. So let me just give you a broad idea about what does automation mean, what does contracting mean, and what does alternate careers mean. So automation was that, you know, the cost of technology will become cheaper than labor. Then you will have artificial intelligence as a force to engage with, and the traditional structures of workplaces look and feel will be overlooked. So that this is what basically everybody said. Contracting, people will take more than one job, will do an assignment and move out. hence they will work for multi companies rather than one, will be hired on the value and skills that they bring and not around position, and the power of networks will supersede hierarchy. So that's about contracting. And alternate careers is basically opening up of non-traditional jobs and roles, reduction on the number of jobs in the traditional sector. There will be a diversified workforce, you know, in terms of talent. It's all going to be skill sets. And organizations will be non-linear and resemble a network of jobs. So that's what these three mean. So now let's get on to the next slide. Nancy, if you could take us to the next slide. Yeah, so artificial intelligence and emotional intelligence. And this is what I wanted to get the entire thing around automation, around this thing, saying that if we want to stay relevant in our professions, we will need to focus on skills and capabilities that artificial intelligence has trouble replicating, which is understanding, motivating, and interacting with human beings. There's little doubt that regardless of your job function, the nature of your job will change markedly over the next decade as a result of AI. In order to stay relevant, humans cannot afford to distance themselves or attempt to circumvent the proliferation of artificial intelligence. Rather, we need to embrace the new reality and double our efforts to develop a critical superpower, which is within ourselves, which is emotional intelligence. And that is that intelligence which will be the computer or the artificial intelligence cannot replicate it, which is understanding the entire thing of empathy, the thing of motivating. You know, you won't get people motivating you to, you know, sort of, okay, do this, do that, you know, somebody who's behind you. And also the way humans interact, that is where there will be a lacunae from the AI thing. So that is where the humans will start filling it. So now here I want to stop and ask, what does emotional intelligence mean? I mean, I've given a broader picture, but would you all know what does emotional intelligence mean? I would really like to see some comments on that. Okay, empathy. Meenakshi is saying the ability to manage emotions, right? What else? Dealing with fellow humans in an empathetic way. Perfect. Very good. What else? What does emotional intelligence mean? Ability to handle relationships. Now tell me, these kind of emotions, will they be able to, if you know, you're talking about emotions, you're talking about feelings, you're talking about understanding the feeling of people beyond words, recognizing emotions, to handle and control relationships. Do you think, with the face of technology, artificial intelligence will sometimes be able to do this? Is it possible? Yes or no? To some extent, yes. Yeah. So that's what the example that, that's what the answer that I was looking. It might not, and, you know, I might not be, you know, you never know what is going to happen. You can never say never. But it could be possible because, I have a mentor who sits out of Switzerland, and she had attended a conference where she said that, you know, there was this, she was at a part of a panel, and she said that they were people, you know, we're all human beings. And of course, there was this robot who was actually moderating the discussion, and she looked, and you know, you have this humanoid kind of robots which look like you and they talk like you, and she was very, very impressed because she said that, you know, it was not like a typical computer asking you stated commands, but it was this person where this robot was able to take in emotions and the conversations from the group and you know, sort of respond on that. And she was saying that, you know, this entire thing of emotional intelligence that we are talking about could also start getting replicated in the future. But as of now, as what we think, and most of the futurists and most of the historians who are talking about, they're saying that EQ is one thing that, you know, humans will be adapted. And that is why we are sort of ruling the world right now, as opposed to other animals who were with us together. So you know, I want you to be, you know, cognizant of the fact that anything is possible. Anything you think is possible in this world. So a smart machine may be able to diagnose complex business problem and recommend actions to improve an organization. A human being, however, is still best suited to jobs like spurring the leadership team to action, avoiding political hot buttons, identifying savvy individuals to lead change. While AI, as of now, and maybe in the next 5 years, afford companies unprecedented capabilities in terms of calculations, more detailed analytical processing powers than the human mind can, it cannot on its own accord to an extent exclude EQ capabilities as of now. So this presents an exciting opportunity for the leaders of tomorrow, which is you all, as to why, you know, how you could, you know, sort of ingrain EQ within yourself. While your level of EQ is likely deeply ingrained as of basis your current situation, basis your current experiences, it is not rigid. That would mean that it is possible with dedicated effort, you can go a long way towards improving your EQ levels as well. It's not like, you know, okay, I've taken EQ test and I've got into this spectrum, and so I remain there. EQ can develop. It's all behaviors. So there are a couple of actionable steps that, you know, if we should feel empowered, perhaps compelled to take in the age of AI. Can you go to the next slide, Nancy? Okay, sorry. Maybe the previous slide. No, keep it in the previous slide. Sorry. Okay, so there are three things that, you know, I would say that if with your level of EQ is, as I said, you know, there's some actionable steps that we should, you know, if we feel empowered, we should be taking the age of AI. One is embrace the rise of AI. Gartner projects that by 2020, you are more likely to have a conversation with a chat box than with your spouse. So AI will continue to replace functions traditionally carried out by humans. So it does, you know, it helps us if we want to move into the future that we embrace AI rather than, you know, get irritated or get upset with it. You know, sometimes we do have this entire conversation saying, oh, Google knows where I'm going. Oh, Google tells me before somebody else, even the airline tells me whether my flight is on time or not on time. Maybe we need to just, you know, sort of start accepting that this is the future. Secondly, recognize where you stand in terms of your EQ. Many factors play a role in one's emotional intelligence. Take a note of where you stand today. There are various kinds of tools which are there, which are available, which are freely available, which are also available at a price. But, you could look at a couple of assessments and figure out what is your EQ quotient. If you cannot go to your organization HR and try and ask them, saying that if you have an EQ tool or an EQ class that you could possibly attend. If you cannot, then thirdly, invest in EQ learning opportunities. In fact, everything is at the touch of a button right now. Go to, you know, online courses like Coursera or Udemy and allocate time for EQ learning initiatives. Compelling scientific evidence has already emerged, citing a positive relationship between EQ and job performance. So, and I really reckon that this relationship will only be fortified in the upcoming years. So try and get yourself into one of these programs and, embrace AI and work on your EQ. That is what is the learning from this slide. So now I will stop and I will ask if there are any questions. Nancy, is it possible to, you know, open up sometimes so that one person can at least speak so that, you know, I can feel a little more engaged? Okay. So if anybody has any question, you know, we have put the lines on. If you all can just use, instead of using video, please use audio and speak. Is there anyone?
I don't have any questions. This is Manisha.
Hi, Manisha. Okay.
Hey, this is Swati. I just put something on chat to say, do you have any recommendations? While you said Coursera and other stuff, but any specific courses that you would suggest for EQ development?
So I am pretty partial to mind tool assessment. You can do a Google called mind tool. It is a simple 15 question assessment that as of now assesses your EQ level and also offers recommendation in terms of actionable steps to improve your scores. So I think that is what you could possibly do. Otherwise, if you just type in Coursera, you can, and if you want to know more about EQ, then there are hundreds of courses there. You just type EQ and then there will be a lot of courses which will come in.
Sure, thanks.
Any other question, please? Okay, great. So now let's move to the second prediction, which is about contracting. Now in contracting and the gig economy. Now, how many of you know what is the gig economy? Can somebody tell me? Please keep yourself on mute because I can hear, aeroplane sound, etc. So whoever is wanting to speak, please come online and ask a question. Can someone tell me what does the gig economy mean? Nancy, please change the slide. Okay. So a gig economy gets its name from each piece of work being akin to an individual gig. Although such work can fall under multiple names, it has previously been called the sharing economy, mostly in reference to platforms such as, you know, Airbnb, Uber, even, you know, you have a coaching app right now called the Hap Coach, you know, and they're also known as a collaborative economy. However, at its core, app-based platforms that, you know, sort of give out work in bits and pieces, you know, or, you know, people like driving passengers or cleaning homes, you know, you have those. Some also refer to it as a platform economy. But not all gig economy roles are based around a technology platform. So gig economy workers can also work for more traditional companies which have changed how the staffing system operates. And that is what this study also sort of, you know, sort of predicted, saying that there is going to be a lot of contracting and the gig economy, where the trend is going to be more towards, there will be more people who will be outsourcing their, most of the organizations will be outsourcing their jobs. Instead of getting people full time, they will be getting people maybe on a contract where people come in for a certain number of time and hours, and then once the project is over, they are then asked to leave. So it is a free market system in which temporary positions are common and organizations contract with independent work for short-term assignments. This exactly is what the gig economy is. Now, as I put it on the slide, the study by Intuit predicted that 2020, which is in the next 2 years' time, and this is an American study, 40% of American workers would be independent contractors is what they are predicting. Now, there could be a number of forces behind the possible rise in short-term jobs. For one thing, in this digital age, the workforce is increasingly mobile and work can increasingly be done from anywhere, so that the job and location are totally decoupled. That also means that freelancers can select among temporary job and projects around the world, while employers can select the best individuals for specific projects from a larger pool than the available in the given area. Otherwise, we are trying to say, okay, we're working in Chennai, now let's look at people who are living in Chennai, and they'll come to office, you know, et cetera, et cetera. So, you know, it actually opens up to say is that even if I'm living in Chennai, I can look at somebody from, say, a Garhwal in India, or even outside of India, maybe say, a Hong Kong or a Shanghai. So that's also possible. Then digitization has also led and contributed to significant decrease in jobs as software replaces some types of works and means, that others take much less time. And other influences include financial pressures on business leading to further staff reductions and the entrance of the millennial generation into the workforce. So the people, the current reality is that the people tend to change jobs several times throughout their working lives. Yeah. So the gig economy can be seen as an evolution of that trend. So these 3-4 points that I mentioned, do you all agree to it? Or is there something that I've missed out, or is there something that you all don't agree to? I can't see the chat. Suddenly, I can't see the chat. Nancy, can you just read out the chat if something somebody has written?
Sure. I don't see any comments as of now. Neetu just said that a gig economy will perhaps bring more diversity and help in hiring the right talent.
Absolutely. Absolutely. The right word is diversity of talent, because again, place and, you know, the location is not this thing. You can, you know, there's a lot of flexibility which will happen. So absolutely. So great. So,
there are a few questions here, Rashmi. Archana from KPMG wants to know, is there a way to measure job satisfaction in a gig economy setup?
You know, as of now, you know, in a sense, there are a couple of ways. If people have started using gig economies, like in an Uber or a Airbnb, where there are a lot of people who are working across the world, so they do have started in terms of efficiency, in terms of what kind of work you are expected to do. So there is obviously something like I'm not saying a performance appraisal, but there is some kind of a performance benchmark which is there, basis which people will be gauged on what they're doing. So that is absolutely there, and that is evolving as we speak. The more and more people, the more and more organizations get into this thing, it'll evolve more. But now with technology, with artificial intelligence, there is so many ways to get people to measure performance and input versus output. I'm sure there will be a lot more which will be coming in the future. But yeah, people who are already in it, there are definite ways to see whether the person is productive or not productive around it.
And there's another observation or a question, which is Anushruti from Genpact wants to know if there's there'll be constant need for a gig worker to keep upgrading their skills. And they'll have to be higher skilled in any particular domain that they are specializing in.
Yeah, so I will be coming to a little bit on skills when I'm talking about alternative careers. So can we take that question at that point of time?
Sure. And will it bring job insecurity as well?
There could be. But again, when we're talking about, job insecurity in a sense that, not just financially, because of course, you're used to a certain amount of money coming to your paycheck at one point of time. Now you're in the gig, then you obviously, financially, your economic is only up till that particular point of project. And after that, you have to move to another project, or you have to find your own ways in finding your own job. So of course, a little bit of that little constraint will be there. So. But it all comes, I think, once everybody is, in fact, there'll be a substantial number of population working around this, then I think it'll become the trend and people will start understanding how they would want to, be taking their career and what works for them. It will be a very individual way of looking at things and doing.
And also, Supriya has an interesting point. She says, gig economy plus millennials. A different skill would be required by managers to manage the workforce.
Yeah, of course. Exactly. And that is where we are saying. You will have a manager who is now so used to be seeing people sitting in front of you and, guiding or, telling you. So the skill of a manager is very, very important, because then he will have to be managing people virtually. So managing in a virtual world is one of the biggest skill, which is going to be, which has already been identified as one of the biggest skill to be nurtured right now in the future. Okay, virtual management is the future, yes. I suddenly start looking at the chat. Okay, so will there be a cut in the salary? No, so it's up to you how you want to look at it, whether it's going to be a cut in the salary or you will be known for your skill set rather than so you might end up getting more amount of for the skill that you get, you might be, you know, sort of ending up getting and earning more for the flexibility of time that you might also be putting in. So it's totally dependent and on what kind of work, how much you are, you know, willing to be putting in your efforts. So it's not going to be a cut in the salary, but it's going to be a different way of earning money for sure. Do you see supervisory people, manager roles going down? No, I do not see that. But what I see is that supervisory people, it will be a very, very niche skill set of people, because as I said, you know, the managers have to be extra perceptive, extra emotionally resilient, because they will be managing people who are not sitting in front of you. You will not be seeing them. That person will be sitting some thousand kilometers away, maybe in a different country. So, but you still have to manage that particular person. So it might get a little more complex and complicated rather than going down. But people who are able to do it the best will actually thrive in this kind of economy.
All right.
Okay. So great. So you know, I understood. In fact, these are all questions which are going on in my mind. So it's good. It's good to see a lot of conversation happening around this. Okay. Anu Shruti is writing, for a gig worker, a steady income is not assured. Do you think banks and financial institutions should think about other lines of credit? I'm sure they will think about it, because even a bank and a financial institution, they're also going to be changing quite a bit. Everything will be on a on the touch of a button. So everything is going to change. You know, it is going to be a changed world, and we just need to be updated and embrace it rather than be a little afraid of it. For knowledge and resource retention, organizations have to take help of high technology. Yes, of course. So, and that is what everybody is trying to do. There's a lot of, if you look at it in your own organization as well, I'm sure there's going to be a major budget which is being put on technological resources and, you know, investment in technology. This will actually impact the global economy as well, as a lot of people will sit at home and work. Absolutely. And it already started happening in slightly more advanced countries like the US and the UK. You know, if you go to this website called Fiverr, Fiverr.com, you will see, you know, there are people who are sitting in, and they're actually, you know, sort of, and those are basically freelancers and not actual contractors. And it's usually more, it started off more on you know, IT-based roles or something around creativity. So they actually, you know, in fact, that day I was making a website for my brother's company. We just put it on Fiverr, and there's this person who actually did the entire website designing, and the person was sitting out of Turkey. And, you know, basis, if we wanted to add up something, we had to, you know, put in a little extra cost, and it went on beautifully. And now, you know, we've sort of hired. There's a lot of stuff which can happen. So it's just about, you know, looking at things in a different way. Okay, Neetu Anand is saying maybe robo manager is the future, virtual management. You need to be the robo manager. Robots are there. In the previous slide, that, you know, emotional intelligence is something that we as humans have got an added edge over artificial intelligence. So I think we need to be the robo manager, which is able to, you know, sort of understand this entire AI concept and also help in, you know, managing the world. Okay. The knowledge and skill set, specialization with operational work will have clear segregation, cause some can be managed virtually and some jobs can't be managed remotely. Yeah. So, as I said, not every job will suddenly become, a contractual job. Of course, there are certain jobs which will be there. So it's not going to be like 100% of the jobs. There will be certain jobs. would laws be for a gig worker as full-time employee? Of course, there are now laws being set. There are a lot of, you know, especially in the UK. In fact, I was listening to one conversation yesterday in the BBC, and they were talking about how to be looking at more forward-looking laws for gig worker. Okay, and Prabhasharan Kaur says that we have an AI personal assistant who takes feedback on behalf of a GM from all the employees. Wow. Which organization is this, Prabhasharan?
Avery Dennison.
Wow. Wow. Very nice. Very nice. So it's, you know, it's, so I heard I'm talking 2030 already started happening. And I think we just need to, you know, sort of embrace it and see and play a bigger part in it rather than, you know, look at it with a little bit of awe. Yeah, of course, stability definitely goes up. So anyway, so let's move on to the next point. So I was talking about how do we stay relevant, you know, in this gig economy, and we can move on to the next slide. Yeah, so that's the next slide already. So, we were talking to a couple of people. In fact, we're also in BD Foundation. We are also something like, we're a startup, and we've also and I've spoken to a lot of people around, and these are the four things which I put on, which says that how to stay relevant in a gig economy. Because most of the important thing for a independent worker is that the stakes of independent worker are enormously high, not just financially but also existentially. So even the most successful, well-established people still worry about money and reputation, and sometimes feel that their identity is at stake. So you can't keep yourself, I can't call myself a consultant, for example, if clients stop your services. So, so we have to continuously, we have to either produce or we perish. So that is going to be there. So everybody has to be totally on their feet in this entire gig economy. So for this reason, productivity is an intense preoccupation for everyone. And can everybody be put on mute, Nancy? Can you mute everybody, please? Yeah. Okay, so the... Okay, so so as I was saying that, even the most successful, well-established people worry about money and reputations and also their identity. So they care about being at work, and they have the discipline to regularly generate products or services that find a market, and have the courage to stay fully invested in the process and output of that labor. And that is how you will stay relevant in a gig economy. Now, they also develop a holding environment, a physical, social, and psychological environment. And for independent workers, a holding environment is necessary because it must be cultivated, otherwise you can get lost. And the five things that I have put down here is, number one is place. So, if you have each workspace is unique with the location, with the furniture, with your decorations, somebody will have their own photograph of their family, etc. But those places are not just protective cocoons, but they also work for the self, because they also evoke a lot of, a kind of emotions that drive people to work. So you have to, as an independent worker, you have to figure out which is your place, where you are able to, work around. Secondly, you really need to have a purpose. Striking out on your own initially involves sometimes it says whatever work would allow, find a foot in the market and let's do the work. But that's not, if you want to be relevant and if you want to sustain it, then... and you are very adamant on succeeding, then it means only taking work that clearly connects to your broader purpose. All could articulate as to why, if you could articulate why this work or that work, that will actually help you also in staying relevant. Because, if you end up doing everything and everything because the business is coming, then you might not end up being relevant. third is about routine. In most of the organizations that we're currently working, there is a routine associated with, you know, which also is associated with safety and maybe also a little like a boring bureaucratic process. However, a growing body of research has shown that, you know, maybe elite athletes, scientific professors, geniuses, artists, and everybody who use routine, it enhances their focus and performance. The professionals who actually end up looking at routine, it helps in improving a person's workflow. It helps in keeping a schedule. It helps to follow a to-do list. It helps to begin the day with the most challenging work or with a client call. So, and, you know, being a gig worker, you can also end up putting in a lot of other routines in your work. Like, you know, you can actually end up taking out time to sleep, or, you know, you can end up meditating. You can go and do your exercise. You can do your personal care. And that comes with the entire thing. But if you have a structured routine, you can do all of these stuff as well. People, having people to turn to for reassurance and encouragement is very, very important. If you start working alone, humans are in the end social creatures. It is important for people to speak to people, to understand what they perceive and how they are being perceived. So it's always good to go to a mentor or peers who help us by, you know, sharing where we can share our, you know, inner thoughts and, you know, even our views about a business. So formal peer groups, which are, you know, or, you know, sometimes, you know, some substitute for, you know, a working environment really helps. It's always good to turn for reassurance and encouragement. Sometimes they're direct role models or some other collaborators. In some cases, they're family members, friends, or contacts in similar fields who can always offer specific work advice, but nevertheless help the gig worker to push through challenging times and embolden them to take risks that the work entails. People is definitely there. And redefining success. In popular management tales, career success usually comes with security and equanimity for independent workers. You need to figure out your balance. You need to figure out what works for you. People in the gig economy must pursue a different kind of success, one that comes from finding a balance between predictability and possibility, between viability and vitality, to feeling present, being authentic and alive in one's work. And that is why you are a gig worker. So if these four or five things are, you know, sort of kept in place, I think you can be a successful gig worker. Any questions now? Okay, I'm waiting for questions. Not really, Prabhashran said. Anybody else? You have been muted because there was a lot of background voice. Any questions around the gig economy? Okay, Manisha Manjanda says, paradigm shift from the current way of working. How do you see people would manage the change? Okay, so how do I see people managing the change? People like you who are here, conversing with me, interacting with me. I think that is one way of step of doing it. And I'm necessarily embracing the new way instead of, you know, we are social creatures. And of course, change always takes time. So the whole idea is to embrace change, not take change for everything, but, you know, try and embrace change to a point where you see that it's relevant, where the world is going to. So be open to it. Be open to the idea of, not working full time. Be open to an idea of having, you know, working for a specific amount of time, working, getting money and moving out. Be open to a time that you don't have to physically go to office, but, you know, sort of manage people sitting out of your home and you could do it. So be open to possibilities. That is how we can manage change. How near is this future in corporates in India? Almost. In fact, I was in this SHRM conference in Delhi 2 weeks back, and the 1.5 day was only spent around discussing around the gig economy. And they were all organizations, HR people who had come in. This is the biggest HR conference in India and across the world, and they're only talking about this. And you have so many newer technologies, especially around HR. I'm talking more from an HR perspective because I've just attended that conference and I've come. There's so many new technologies which have come, which have actually taken out the entire space where humans were required. Even in places like from HR perspective, I'm talking about recruitment executives, the entire chain can actually be given away because there is this technology which is coming in. Interviews can happen now or over the computer. You don't have to actually physically go and interview somebody. And there are a couple of, again, AI tools and testing which is there where you get the right fit for the right candidate. So it is happening as we speak right now. So in the next 5 years, in fact, we will be in a certain journey already. We would have already finished at 10 to 20% of that journey and looking at how now we can embrace it further. Any other question on the gig economy? Okay, great. So now let's move to the next, the third prediction that the research made, which was about alternative careers. Now, alternative careers would mean that, the way I am right now currently being in my career, I might have to be looking at it at a totally different way looking at a newer career for myself. Now, for that, and you can say that, okay, I'm not good in math, so if I want to do something around AI, I will not be able to do it. So we're not saying that. So there are various easier alternatives to totally changing your careers. And I've just listed five of them. The number one is keep your job, change your industry. There was this, this friend of mine who was, who was a lawyer, and she was extremely unhappy in this law firm that she was working in. And she always she had this thing of writing. She was a good writer, and she was a good, she always wanted to move into the media world because she said she can write some great screenplay and stories, and she could work there. So but then she realized that even getting into that kind of industry, she did not have that much of skill set. So what she did was that being a lawyer, she actually went into a media company and she became a lawyer in that media company. And but it also helped her in understanding that industry much better. Though she was ending up doing her core job, which she was qualified for, which was being a lawyer, she was able to sort of understand and able to do a little more work, which was closer to her heart because it was around media and communication, which was very close to her heart. And maybe you never know, because she will now be in touch with those people. She could also pursue her long-time ambition of writing. So, so this is one way that we could possibly look at. Keep your job, change your industry. If, for example, if you are, in a salesperson in a particular organization, in a particular industry, you could, for example, in a pharma sales, you could put your selling skills to a completely different field. You could come and sell maybe HR products. You never know. It certainly takes effort to network your way into a new industry and convince your hiring manager why you're making the change. But it's a whole lot easier than it would be ever to change roles too. Secondly, do something different that requires knowledge of your job. So so this is something exactly what I talked about. This unhappy lawyer friend of mine, where, though she was unhappy about her job, but she actually, sort of got herself, she actually took that entire step to move into a different industry and, do something which that industry that she liked and did something about around it. So, we could do that. Make a move within your company. This is easier said than done. There are a lot of internal job watches which are there. How many of us actually put up a hand to look beyond our work functions? How many of us who are in finance or legal or HR say, okay, maybe can I look at a business or an operations role? How many of us do that? So so you could brainstorm yourself and figure out what you know, you could possibly make a move within your company, because it's more easy, because you're a known entity out there. People might still take a risk on you. So if you're working for a relatively large firm, look around. Are there other roles that seem much more appealing to you? Start talking to people. Learn the in and out of the job. Understand the skills required to do their work and ask for advice on breaking into their world. Maybe even see if you could lend a hand on upcoming projects. And I think that's what most of the people also end up doing, you know. Projects that you could, you know, sort of look at, you know, do with your current job. I understand it won't work everywhere, but if you can show that you're interested in a different type of work, avenues start opening up. You know, there's this inherent saying that, you know, I did not see till now, you know, when you're looking at buying a car of a particular make, you will suddenly see that people are driving that car, that particular make car on the roads. And it's all about being more aware. It's all about, you know, putting your energies in trying to see whether, you know, you can be a little more different. So start being a little more aware, start talking to people, start networking, start thinking beyond what you're doing. That is very, very important. Fourth one, get a side gig. If you can afford the time doing some work outside of your 9-to-5 job, then it will be a wonderful way to get some exposure to your dream career. You know, so for example, I know of so many of people who have, who, you know, sort of put in their hands to, you know, work around the Women Network, or they work around, you know, a couple of them. In fact, there is this entire set of people who have started their own group, which they meet outside on their work. You know, there's this couple of HR friends who have started their own HR career and shaper. They end up meeting, they you know, sort of get people together, and they, you know, invite guests and they invite speakers without any cost, but they are the enablers. They actually get people, and they do it with a full-time job, but they enjoy doing it, and they do it over the weekends. You know, you could do that. I mean, and that is what, and I could see if you're already doing that, if you're already visible, taking up a course, maybe, you know, if you start volunteering in a couple of organizations. This friend of mine, she was volunteering in this entire thing around energy and water. And now she's actually got into a project there. She's left a full-time job, and she's, you know, because that really excited her and worked around her. She actually has now started working there in the development sector, looking around energy and water. So, you know, you never know what kind of career options and opportunities open up for you. And then fifth one is revisit whether you can change ever so often as well. So, okay, this isn't necessarily an alternative to changing careers, but I do think you owe it to yourself to check in once in a while and make sure that, can I really change careers, or I can't really change careers, excuse is still valid. So start talking to your inner voice, because that inner voice will tell you whether I can't or I can. And I challenge you to ask it back, but could I? Maybe the answer is still no, but it really does make sense to make a change. You know, so you could start considering the options, you know, above by taking a little baby steps towards your goal, or talking to a career coach to make your dream a reality. And yes, each of these options requires you to do a lot of work, some networking, some skill building, and maybe some professional help to position your transferable skills. There are organizations like us who help you do that. But it is always good to think about an alternative way of crafting your career, rather than staying in a lackluster job or a job which is irrelevant in the near future, and make yourself more relevant. Whether you make a big change or a small one, we all are rooting for you. So this is about alternative careers. Now look at, go to the next slide, and this is going to be the skills important for the workplace in 2030. This is what the five skills which were there, which we're talking about, which came out in the study. Again, I've talked about emotional intelligence. Second one is critical thinking. Again, critical thinking you can only do if you start critically thinking, you can start questioning yourself and start looking at patterns and start looking at larger structures around you. Whether you are service oriented in a sense, because now everything is going to be customer first, and you all know everybody of us works around this entire thing around service orientation. It'll become even more, especially in a very virtual economy. Design thinking, again, how can we look at things in a little more different way? How can it help individuals and people and societies to help them in their day-to-day life? That is design thinking. And of course, so much of data, so much of artificial intelligence is there. And if whoever can actually start understanding the data and, sort of interpret it, will be the king or the queen of the future. So these are the 4-5 skills that are important in the workplace. So, you all can look at any of the skills where you feel that, you have a strength in, or you feel that you need to be working around. Everything can be worked around. And you could make yourself relevant in this future of work. Next slide, and I'm through with my presentation. I'm open to questions. Okay, any questions? Don't leave, Nancy, just leave it in the last slide which is all about questions. Yeah, that's it. Are we getting a copy of the slide you presented? Of course. Well, Nancy will send it across to you. Nancy, you can actually open it up if anybody has any questions. I think it'll be good to have an interaction. It's just about 8 more minutes. Yeah, so we've opened the line right now. So if anybody wants to ask any question, please feel free to, speak about it.
This is Swati. Just now you mentioned about a website which helps you leverage your skills for other industry and other, platforms. What's the name you mentioned?
Mind Tools.
I am tool.
Mind, MindTools.
Mind.
Nancy, Meenakshi is saying I'm still on mute. Nancy, could you please help unmute? Okay. Okay, so let me ask people, when I went through the presentation, was it something new for you all, or was it, something that you all have been hearing and you've never, it was not new?
Hi, this is Meenakshi here. Thanks for helping me unmute. So your session for me personally was very interesting. I thought it was very relevant. I work for Uber, so quite a few things that you spoke about, remote workforce, gig economy, very, very relevant. I think it's for us, it's today, it's not really somewhere in the future. I actually have a question for you. While we build on our own EQ, how do we enable that for our colleagues and our viewers and the ecosystem that we work in?
Sorry, I didn't get the last point.
So while we work on our own EQ, how do we facilitate that for our peers and the ecosystem that we work in professionally?
Okay, so EQ is something which happens it's a very individual thing because people have to understand where their own emotional resilience is. This entire thing of inclusion that we talk about, where we are looking at people to understand, not make judgments, speak only after you've looked at the facts, to being, you know, being empathetic, not having your decisions based on, you know, some previous experiences. You know, those kind of things are all, you know, EQ, you know, how you are emotionally connected and how you are as an individual. So I think if it, as a culture, everybody is, you know, following this, then, you know, we can look at more emotionally intelligent workspaces with other people around. And if you are from the business where you're managing a team, if you could do that to your team members, that would be great. Where you're giving time for people to listen, to understand each other, to make the other person feel belonged. That is where EQ will start working in. But it's very individual. It has to come from the inside as well. Great. So I was asking everybody, was it something very new to you all, this what I said, or is it something, some comment or something that you would want to say? What was your comment when I said it's already started happening now, it's just not 15 years from now, but it's already happening? How do you all feel? Ajay, gig economy was certainly a new thing. Okay. But it is not, because it's already been in most of this travel-looking economy, like in the US and the UK, in Europe, it's already been there for the last 4 or 5 years. So we also need to see how aware of are we of our own, are we only looking at our work, our place, our country, or are we also more aware of what is happening around the world? Are we taking our time? Thank you. Somewhat disorienting to see, but a very good presentation. Okay, great. Thank you so much. Okay, heard about the gig, but the details that you have are very helpful. Okay, great. So I think it's all about, you know, so if you look at yourself also, you know, I am in my early 40s and I see most of my friends around this age group. Everybody, in fact, they say that, you know, everybody is in a stage of their career where they have to look at, you know, something, doing something different for themselves, because most there is a lot of conversation around job losses. There is a lot of conversation around how people, what's next for me? And that's everybody in the mid 40s, at least I know everybody's talking, whether be it a male or a female. So I think we need to see ourselves and we need to start making ourselves relevant as to what is more important to us. I know of a friend of mine. I've been a banker now for the last 8 years. I've been, a gig worker. You know, we've been working in this entire space on around inclusion. And I feel myself very, very energized and more relevant right now as opposed to what I was, 8 years back when I was in a career with a 9-to-5 job. So, and now I see myself actually ending up advising and talking to people who I thought were, been there, done there. But I see those people who are very, very confident and very, very out there, not being very confident about themselves. So we have to be very relevant right now. I know so many of my ex-banker friends who have realized that. And maybe they've lost their jobs and they finally said, okay, now what next for me? And a couple of people have actually said, okay, I like speaking to people. People is something which I really like, and I used to really like managing teams. So they've done a coaching course and have become a coach. And some people are really, really, really successful because they've been able to, see what is their passion, and they've been able to, with their experience, a business coach works very well for them, because right now everybody is looking for a business coach, and with their years of experience where they were managing directors, etc., it really works out for them, and they are very well, they're pretty marketable in the market right now. So we need to start looking at ourselves and start looking at things saying that, okay, what next for me? And not next for me, not in the current role, but what next? Can I become a farmer? Can I open up a restaurant? You know, if this is what I'm interested in. It is highly possible that you could do it. So start looking at newer possibilities.
All right. So I think time is up. We can take any one last question and then we'll wrap it up, please.
Great. It was lovely talking to all of you. And thank you, Nancy, for putting this together. We will send you the presentation, and in case you want to write to me or chat with me, Nancy, just please send down my email address as well. I would love to interact with people who would want to take it further with me. Thank you so much.
Sure. Thank you everyone. She's running out of the house, finding a place.